Yes, indubitably old sport.
What's up, guys? Pat here from Bros Let's Talk. Giving this a second try since no one was kind enough to jump in the chat and let me know that my mic was not working in the last video. So thanks to everyone who jumped in and just watched me, my mouth moving with no audio. Really appreciate it. But this is Old Sport Live. This is something new we're going to start doing. I'm hoping the other guys are going to be willing to jump on and do things like this with me. But the focus on these is to try and basically use these as a one-off open forum format to try and get to things that we don't get to talk to week to week on our podcasts. And this past week, surprisingly, we didn't even talk about the NFL offseason at all, the Bears, anything. We basically talked quarantine the entire time, what we were doing to keep ourselves sane, what we're watching, how we're keeping our minds, our bodies healthy. This, for me, is a way that I'm going to try and keep myself sane, is by jumping in, doing these live videos, talking about some things we didn't get to talk about on the podcast. Today, I'm going to focus on the Chicago Bears offseason, the moves Ryan Pace has made, and what I think the team has done or needs to continue to do to move forward. So let's take a look at some notable moves the Bears have made this offseason. They re-signed Danny Trevathan to a three-year, $21.75 million deal. I'm good with that. I like Danny Trevathan. I think he's the leader of our defense. I think he's a better linebacker than Nick Kwiatkowski, who played his way to a contract with the Raiders. So good for him. Hope he does well, but I'm good with Trevathan. They cut Prince and Mukamara, cut Taylor Gabriel and Leonard Floyd as well. This saved them roughly $18 million in cap space. They used that to sign Jimmy Graham to a two-year, $16 million deal and Robert Quinn to a five-year, $70 million deal. And then they traded with the Jaguars for Nick Foles. They gave up a fourth-round conditional pick that they received for Adrian Amos signing with the Packers last season. And then by cutting Mike Davis, they were able to retrieve that pick. So that's how they were able to get Foles, which at first you kind of wondered, do you really need to give up a fourth-round pick to get Foles? But you just saw Kyle Allen go to the Redskins for a fifth-round pick, so not terrible value there, especially for a guy who has a Super Bowl MVP and has a proven playoff pedigree to be able to win games in the postseason. The Jimmy Graham signing, I'm not crazy about. He seems like he's past his prime. His last two stops have been underwhelming. It gives whoever's quarterback next season a good red zone target at very least to throw the ball up to. But when you see a guy like Eric Ebron sign a couple days ago for 2 years, $12 million, it looks like there was better value out there at the tight end position. So I'm not crazy about that one. I do like Robert Quinn as a player. He's 29, so he's a little bit older. In a perfect world, Leonard Floyd would have worked out, but he didn't. So that forced your hand to have to sign another pass rusher to opposite Khalil Mack. And Quinn proved last year that when he's opposite an elite pass rusher, like DeMarcus Lawrence, he was last year, he'll be outside of Khalil Mack this year, he can be effective. But he's not an every down player. And for the value, I know he signed for 5 years, $70 million. The Browns just signed Jack Conklin, left tackle, for 3 years, $42 million. Which, if you break it down annually, that's the same pay rate that Robert Quinn just got, $14 million per year. I personally would have rather that money go towards the offensive tackle position with a guy like Jack Conklin, who's one of the better tackles in the NFL, and we could have afforded him. So it bothers me a little bit that offensive line does not seem to be a priority at this point, considering we lost Kyle Long and the shakiness that we had up front last year. I do like the trade for Foles, though. Took me a couple days, to think about it, but Trubisky needed competition. He didn't have a true competition at backup last year. Chase Daniel was there to be an extension of a coach on the field. He did both years he was here. He did what you can hope a backup will do, and that's go 500 when you have to play, when you're called to duty. And both years he showed that he's a flash in the pan. He can get you for one game, but once you game plan for him, he's done. So now we've got a guy who can legitimately come in, push Mitch to be a starter, and if not, then be the starter, because if Mitch can't handle it, then, you know, what are you going to do? Foles is a guy, like you said, he's won a Super Bowl MVP, proven playoff pedigree, So I like the trade. Overall, though, I'm going to give the... What up, Johnny? Thanks for tuning in. Appreciate you. First of all, since you're... Can you hear me? Because the last video I did, no one can hear me, and I felt like an idiot when I watched it back. So I appreciate you tuning in into the chat. Here's my grade, though, for the Bears offseason so far. I'm going to go ahead and give it... There we go. C+. I wanted to give it a B-. I really did, but I don't love the Jimmy Graham signing, and I would have preferred the Robert Quinn money be put towards Jack Conklin at tackle. I also think that there are issues at wide receiver depth that we need to address right now. Allen Robinson's obviously a number one option, but Anthony Miller is a flash in the pan when he isn't hurt, and when he is hurt, he's not doing anything, obviously. Javon Wims looks like he has some upside, but the fact that he hasn't been able to get on the field consistently shows that there might be some sort of mental block or something else there. So you always have to wonder when guys aren't able to get on the field. Johnny, I agree with you. I think Graham's glory days are over. His last two stops have been underwhelming in Seattle and then in Green Bay. He hasn't been the same player since he left the Saints and Sean Payton's offense. So I do think it gives them a good red zone target, but I don't think we can expect him to be the Jimmy Graham of old, which in that case, I don't even know what's the point of the signing then. We now have like six tight ends on our roster too, and one of them might be decent. So I just feel like he's addressing areas of need, but they're not the biggest areas of need, which in my opinion is the offensive line. So I don't know what he's waiting on there, but I guess only time will tell. So, the quarterback is really where I want to focus, though, because I do like that move. I like the idea of having a true quarterback competition with Trubisky to really push him. So here's the quarterback comparison of the two for their careers. Now, Foles has played in about 17 more games than Mitch, and his numbers are strange because he's been a spot starter in and out, whereas Mitch has been basically three consecutive seasons as a starter now. Foles, a little bit better touchdown interception ratio, obviously boosted by that one year where he went 27-2, but around the same completion percentage. The rating is in the same range as well, although Mitch's is heavily increased by his ability to run, so that helps his rating as well. Yardage, Foles a little bit more yards per game as well, so I don't think either of them is a home run hitter for a quarterback. But Foles has proven time and time again that he can win in the playoffs. He's won big games. He's been a Super Bowl MVP. And I think that when Nick Foles has been successful, it's when he's been put in a position to be successful. He's in a good system with good coaches around him. He's comfortable. We saw it in both stops in Philly. And then those two stops in Philly got him big contracts. St. Louis didn't work out. Ended up in Kansas City, and then he ended up back in the Eagles. He won the Super Bowl MVP, got to the Jaguars, got off to a decent start, actually, but then just got hurt, unfortunate, and then Minshew Mania took over. But I think the best-case scenario here is Foles is able to push Trubisky in a way that no one else has been able to at this point, because Foles is a guy who can actually take his job from him. So hopefully that ignites a fire under Mitch like we haven't seen before. It brings out the best in him, and he comes out next year firing. That's honestly best case scenario for Bears fans. We want Mitch to be a great quarterback. It just hasn't happened to this point, and you can't force it. And the same token, though, you can't just sit and wait for him to become a great quarterback, because it might never happen, and then all you did was waste this defense's window. Because this is a great defense. I know that they took a step back last year. They had some injuries, but they were still top 10 defense in all categories. If they're healthy again this year, they get Akeem Hicks back. You put Robert Quinn outside of Khalil Mack now, and all of a sudden you got a pretty dangerous front four again. So I think it's going to be huge that we get good quarterback play this year, because that was the difference between 2 years ago and last year. When we were winning games, we had solid quarterback play. Last year, we didn't. Mitch took a step back. And if you're denying it, you weren't watching the games. So I mentioned that I think that Foles is successful and has been most successful in the NFL when he's put in a good position. And I think the Bears have set that up for him. And I'm excited about that opportunity. This graphic here is via NFL on CBS on Facebook. And it shows Nick Foles' connections to the Bears coaching staff. with Matt Nagy starting. He was the offensive quality coach when Foles was a rookie with the Eagles, and he was also the quarterback's coach after Foles was cut by the Rams and re-signed with the Chiefs. So he's familiar with the system. Johnny, I'm right there with you, man. Mitch was terrible last season. I guess I was being a little, I was going easy on him a little bit, but he was terrible last year. Back to the coaching staff. Bill Lazor, our new offensive coordinator, he was Foles' QB coach in 2013 when he went 27 touchdowns, 2 interceptions, and then new quarterbacks coach John DeFilippo was with the Eagles in 2017 when Foles went from backup to Super Bowl MVP. He was also the offensive coordinator in Jacksonville last year before Foles got hurt. That was going to be a good pairing. So I do like this thought that there are guys on the coaching staff that have worked with Foles before. They're comfortable working with Foles, and he's comfortable in their system. Because, again, I think that is the biggest thing in Foles versus Nick Foles on the Eagles versus Nick Foles on the Rams. Nick Foles on the Eagles both times was in systems he was comfortable with, coaching staffs he was comfortable with, and they didn't ask him to do anything more than he needed to do. Then, when he had those great seasons, with that comes huge paydays. And who's not going to take a huge payday? You'd be an idiot not to. But with huge payday comes huge pressure, and he gets thrown into the mix in St. Louis, just never worked out. Sucked there. Gets thrown into the mix in Jacksonville, gets hurt the first game. Gardner Minshew comes in, goes on a nice little run, puts Foles in an impossible position. The thing I think to take most out of last year's situation, though, and why I think this year's situation will be a positive regardless of how it turns out, is that Foles has handled everything like a consummate professional. So there was never any rumblings last year that when Gardner Minshew took over and then Foles was the starter and then they named Minshew the starter again after Foles was healthy, you never heard Foles complaining. He took his job as a backup in stride. He's a consummate professional, and I think that in itself makes the quarterback room so much better, because you want a guy who he's going to go in and try and win this starting job. That's going to be his number one goal. Nick Foles is a competitor first and foremost, and don't let anyone tell you any different. But he's also a professional to where if Mitch Trubisky comes in this offseason, figured out how to read film, worked his ass off, beats out Nick Foles, Nick Foles is going to do everything in his power to make Mitch Trubisky as successful as a quarterback as possible. And honestly, that's all you can really ask for in a backup quarterback. But I am pushing for Foles to be the starter this year. I think we've seen the most we're going to see from Mitch. I think by your third or fourth year, yeah, some guys break the mold, like Drew Brees. He didn't start being great until later, until his second, basically his second team when he went over to the Saints. But he's a flash. He's not the exception, or he's the exception to the rule. He's not the rule. Most guys, after their third or fourth year, if you're in your fourth year and you don't know how to read defenses yet, I don't think you're just going to all of a sudden learn how to read defenses. And I don't care what Patrick Mahomes said about him just learning how to read defenses. He has generational arm talent and escapability. Mitch does not have those things, so I think it's very important to have competition at the quarterback position this year. Unfortunately, I think we're going to receive a little bit of both players, whether it be because of injury, inconsistent play, whatnot. I think we're going to see a little bit of Trubisky this year. I think we're going to see a little bit of Foles, and hopefully we can find a healthy medium to win enough games to go on a playoff run this year. I think our division is a tough one, but definitely a winnable one. It remains to be seen. Unfortunately, this is the reality of our situation, and I'm sorry for the nightmares that this photo is going to produce, but Mitchell Trubisky is basically going to be our quarterback next season. We're going to get a healthy mix of both players, hopefully more Foles than Trubisky, in my opinion, but that remains to be seen. Again, best case scenario, Foles pushes Trubisky to heights that we never thought he could reach because he finally has some true competition going against him. Overall, moving forward, I still want to see Ryan Pace address the offensive line. I'm assuming he will do so in the draft, but he has not done well drafting offensive linemen in the past, so I don't really have a lot of confidence there. So they got to figure something out, though, because they can't just go in trying to repurpose the same line that was not very good last year. All right, that's all I got, guys. I appreciate you tuning in. Sorry for the technical difficulties on the first video, but hey, it would not be a Bros Let's Talk production without technical difficulties. If there's anything you guys want to see us talk about moving forward, let us know. We'll throw it out there. We'll probably talk maybe Bulls Warriors argument next time, although not much of an argument in my opinion. Regardless, I appreciate everyone who jumped in to the chat or just watched. Appreciate you guys. I'll be back here. I'm really bored with the quarantine, so I'll be doing these more frequently. I will see you guys. Love you guys.
Yes. Indubitably, old sport.